Some people think interior design is a look. In fact, it must be really fun buying furniture, is something one person said to me once. But I see it differently. We spend 87% of our lives inside buildings. How they are designed really affects how we feel, how we behave. Design is not just a visual thing. It's a thought process. It's a skill. Ultimately, design is a tool to enhance our humanity. It's a frame for life. Still got a really strong design quality.
I just kind of added a note that's a stone floor.
All our projects start with a strategy, basically prioritizing people, putting the human experience at the beginning of the design process. Each of these chairs has met many of these criteria. I think we should narrow it down to two. Michael, what are the pluses and minuses of this chair?
The materials are great. We really like it.
It's got real tactile
memory,
actually.
Yeah. And it's quite easy to handle. It's nice.
In our process, we interrogate the place, the client, and then empathize, because empathy is a cornerstone of design.
It's great, that one.
That's a good chair. Quite a challenge, hasn't it?
Yeah.
You want to feel easy and relaxed, so I think it does come down to these two. And then from that process of interrogation and empathy, that's when the imaginative process kicks in. Interiors, which for ages have been treated as being a slightly silly aside design, is now beginning to be taken seriously.
Glancing at the artistic lines of this modern home, we forget the old idea that houses should follow past and out-of-date fashions.
Traditionally, interior design has been a predominantly visual medium. It's been rather frothy and flamboyant. It's all about showmanship and theatricality. Ilse's approach is much more subtle. It's much more sensual. It's about how things feel and smell, as much as how things look. She wants to imbue people with a sense of well-being, empowerment, and sort of gentle joyfulness.
By many people, Ilse's seen as something of an icon because she has developed a whole new way of looking at interiors.
One of the qualities that distinguishes her work from that of other interior designers is that it's about how we experience a room and how we ourselves feel in a room to satisfy the subconscious.
Ilse's strength is her humanity and her caring, that she really cares about well-being, everything that's surrounded by us that is really done with this care, with this love. that makes it, that makes you kind of feel good. And not just look good too.
I am a very self-motivated person. I actually had always worked. I started working on the side when I was 13, because I've never wanted to ask for money. I've always wanted to be independent. I worked at Pitt's Cottage as a waitress, I'm sure completely illegally, serving coffees and shortbread biscuits, which had a cherry in the middle and looked like a breast. I remember it so clearly. From a kid, I was interested in how people behave differently in different spaces. That fascinated me. So when I went to university, I studied history and history of architecture. After university, I was the studio manager for an architect. And from there, was hired to work on the editorial team of an architect's magazine because I knew my stuff. So when I was asked to start El Deco, it was a no-brainer because I really wanted to do a contemporary magazine that was warmer and reached a bigger audience.
Ilse has always treated interior design both as a designer and magazine editor originally, with a seriousness and a complexity that was arguably lacking before.
Editing a magazine is really about having a very close connection to your audience and knowing how to reach them, how to excite them, how to inspire them. It's a conversation, essentially, that you have with your reader. We presented these livable spaces. The journey of seeing 4,000 or 5,000 different interiors, seeing how people really use space, of which spaces really worked, of which spaces really touched our audience. I mean, that was really my design education. But I wanted to do my own thing. I wanted to make things. I wanted to get my hands dirty and really do something for myself. I'm driven by my curiosities. By learning more about what made people comfortable in space, researching in anthropology, behavioural science and so on, that really made me understand how we discover the world. I wrote a book called Sense Your Home. In that book, I went through the senses because it seemed to me fascinating. That is, after all, how we experience the world. We are our bodies. Writing Sense Your Home was the aha moment, because it wasn't the current understanding of design. So I knew that my days as a two-dimensional person were over, and I really wanted to move into three and figure out whether I could work in that field. My first project was immediately after I left Art Decoration, when Nick Jones from Soho House asked me to help him with Babington House, his first hotel out in the countryside. I had no practical experience at that point, so it was pretty adventurous of him to ask me. Nick started on a path of it being rather traditional. It's in the country, so it was going to be a country house hotel. I was very clear that that was the last thing it should be. It was for the media and advertising and film crowd. So my proposal said it should be this very informal place that you could just treat as if it was your own, like a family house of a friend where the parents had gone away for the weekend and left the keys to the drinks cabinet. And now that doesn't seem so radical, but really then it was the first of a kind. And then Nick asked me to do the next Soho House in New York. And that's really where the studio began, because that's when I brought people in to help me, and it grew from there. And it has been one project after another since then. Cicconi's was an old failing Italian restaurant in the centre of London. We looked at making it something that had the character of the grand Italian station bar. Those wonderful, democratic, beautiful spaces that was very much like a stage for the staff that worked there. In an interior made with materials all from the region around Venice. High Road House Chiswick was about making this great public space downstairs, and then rooms that reflected the simplicity of the arts and crafts houses that were all around it. We did in the Old Bell, a really quite smelly pub when we first saw it. We were asked to define what an English coaching inn would be, translating that into furniture, materials, food, uniforms. We also worked with Matthias Dahlgren in Stockholm to develop two restaurants, which would be the physical manifestation of his love and philosophy of Swedish gastronomy. We did the first Aesop in the UK. The owner said that the thing about skincare that made the difference was not just what was in the product, but the ritual of daily maintenance. So we put the sink in the middle of the store. The notion of taking care of yourself elevated through design. What we're really interested in is translating the client, the future life of a building, into a design language. So quite a range. What was really exciting was to figure out if our approach worked for very different people in very different places. We managed to create these special identities. I mean, people said that while they didn't look the same, they did have a similar feeling. By creating places that really affect people through five senses, they had a real connection that was very unusual at the time. While I know what works for me visually, I need to make sense of it through writing in order to then do what I do. I need both hands to speak to each other. So the second book was trying to figure out how to structure my design thoughts into actually a design manifesto.
Ilse makes things easy to comprehend because she's broken them down into very basic ideas. 20 plus years ago, Ilse had very new ideas, and I think it takes a long time for a new idea to really become an established idea, and so it's been a process.
I grew up in a pretty progressive family. Both my parents were extremely free-thinking. My mother was a trained artist. And my father was an investigative journalist for the Sunday Times and an economist. My father was very demanding academically. I learned how to prove myself very young because he was of the mind that humans don't question or interrogate reality before they have an opinion. If you interrogate a situation, actually the answers present themselves to you. And my mother was adventurous. She gave us total freedom, really, with our own environment to express ourselves. But when I was a teenager, my mother got quite sick. You know, she was in her mid-30s. I spent quite a lot of time going in and out of hospitals to hang out with her. Those great long corridors reduced people to patients waiting for the doctor in the white coat to sort of march up and down. They were really inhuman. To see that a building could have such an impact on the way people felt, on the way they interacted. It was a real revelation that human values are non-negotiable. That combination of interrogation and empathy is something that's been with me from the very beginning. when we first approach a project, we always hold off what our opinion is. So we ask questions. We watch a lot. We listen. I always say to my team, we've got two eyes, two ears, and one mouth, and we should use them in that proportion.
They do have that knowledge. Yeah, well, they are.
Through that process of interrogation and empathy, we can understand really what it is we're looking at. Our expertise in terms of process was relevant when it came to working on a project like with IKEA. They noticed the humanity of our approach, and that's something that is embedded in their ideology as a company. They're very interested in how we can bring those human values into their restaurants.
This has to be a very robust vision because it's going to be translated around the world.
Absolutely. That's a huge thing.
The restaurant has always done as an afterthought, really, because the store is the mammoth thing to get right.
Yeah.
And, you know, like we talk about the end of the system, that's the bit that gets the last bits of the money and the last bits of the time. And so it'd be quite interesting to reverse that process.
You know, I didn't even know it was called a restaurant.
No,
I just
I think
thought
that's awesome.
You know, that's really interesting.
It's a cafeteria. They can use that space to encourage and give sort of behavioral cues to people to eat more healthily, especially kids. Although it sounds like the hot dog is something that will be hung on to.
Maybe that's okay.
It's fine, it just needs to be like sort of framed in a different language.
Yeah.
Not advertised on.
But apparently the veggie ball is doing brilliantly.
That's great.
The next steps will be to go do some very rigorous observation in IKEA and in the existing environments. Mm.
Changes on this scale could make a massive impact. Almost every client finds this room their favourite space. Each project has its specific material language that we might use in terms of how they're laid, how they're finished. Materials are the thing that tell the truth. It's something we go into great detail. Humans naturally are drawn to materials. We discover the world through our senses. What we're interested in is how materials speak to us. The things that touch the skin, the things that really give you memory, we focus a lot on that. Materials are much more compelling and convincing once you see them in context, or at least in the character of light that will hit it, and ideally in association with the other materials that will be with it. Really, it's that combination of materials that speak to each other and create this tactile, warm, and very physical environment. So, for example, when we were working on Cathay Pacific airport lounges, you really need to choose materials that are functional, but yet luxurious. Now, these are people who are tired, who are probably jet-lagged, and a lounge is a place to make them feel human. And typically, an airport lounge will often line chairs up rather institutionally. And we didn't want to do that. We wanted it to have the sense of domestic space, but yet function well. That was a challenge. The lounge needed to have minimal maintenance, to be somewhere that could withstand many, many people per day going through with wheelie suitcases which bash the walls. So paint, for example, was a no-go. It needed to be materialized in a way that expressed Cathay and not, for example, another airline. So when it came to choosing materials for the first class lounge, in the hallway, we chose onyx. It's a natural material, it's from the area, it's an Asian material. And because it's robust. It's not the cheapest material you could find, so we needed to balance it with something more down to earth that offset it. So we chose a limestone. But then we needed to add warmth. We actually understand materials best by contrast. Our senses are wired in such a way that we understand that rough feels rougher by contrast with smooth. To get the best out of these materials, we needed to find its opposite. So mohair velvet, which is a very robust velvet, which was totally durable, but feels luxurious. So offsetting the hardness, the coolness of the onyx and the limestone, then bringing in something natural, both in finish and also form. And then to bring in the touch of luxe, it had a brass base. So it was less about the aesthetics or the appearance, although that's, you know, obviously in the mix, but much more about how to make an environment that made people feel better after they'd been there than when they arrived. It's all about well-being. That means that when people walk into it, they don't know why they feel the way they feel, but it's actually all been orchestrated.
But I don't know if that's enough, you know, like...
The execution of our projects comes down to the tools.
Tangible tools, such as materials, sketching, and all the technical tools, CAD, Vectorworks, etc. And the ultimate measurable tool, the tape measure, a blissfully simple, essential tool. Dimensions for us as a studio are super important. When we're making furniture, for example, 3 inches is a massive difference as to whether something is comfortable or whether it's the right dimension to have a conversation. I prefer a table where the dimensions enhance conversation, where you're closer together. What's interesting about tables is that they can be metaphors of power and confrontation. The conference table is typically wide and long, and that the one at the top is the one who pulls all the strings. The informal table for me is a more lovely thing. The together table is a really good example. It's actually narrow enough to have a conversation quite comfortably, 75 centimeters. And then the oval. An oval does give you the possibility to squeeze more people in. Design that encourages people to be close together is a good thing.
I didn't initially see product as being something that we either could or should do, but when we were designing some interiors, we needed to do specific products for those interiors because we couldn't find them.
The brass cabinet was an original piece that we did for the Aesop store, and we evolved the design for other clients. To make a good product is so much more complicated than just throwing a sketch over a wall or a CAD drawing to a manufacturer. Design is a relationship with the maker. The best results are always about the collaboration. You really need to sample it and refine a product. It takes many iterations so that ultimately it can live on its own. So, for example, when we were designing the Cinelig range for Ikea, it was very important to us that we make furniture that could reach the whole world.
The project for Ikea, really trying to understand what is mass manufacturing, and instead of maybe kind of say, oh, this is horrible, is really questioning and really trying to understand what could be mass manufacturing can give us a great benefit to us because it can give us access to things that for everyone.
For many people, IKEA is a big, bad, cheap furniture warehouse. But actually, what's really interesting is strategically what is in that system that can be used positively, using design to make things better. The basis of our relationship was to bring emotional values into that system and come out with products that are sustainable, but people really love.
What we wanted to do was not just product development. We wanted to do a development of an experience. And since Studio Ilse is working with both products and interior design, that's like a perfect fit. This is actually 1 year from when we started, still here. It's kind of nice.
It's great to see it in the store. Looking at materials that we could work with, we came to love cork because it's very abundant, utterly sustainable, there's no waste. It goes from being the bark harvested in the very old way with skilled craftsmen who know how to do it without damaging the trees. In order to get that tactility, we had to work very hard to find a new coating. Design thrives on restrictions, actually. I think of it as a primal drive that, you know, you need those tight restrictions and then somehow or other you come out of it. We looked at the process of making ceramics in Vietnam and saw that a way of creating imperfection and difference was staring us straight in the face, which is that the jars are dip-dyed. What you got was there's never one the same.
The process was nearly 3 years. People don't realise, I think, how long it really takes to make something that comes out at this price, in these quantities, bringing together good design and this scale. It's just, for us, a really, really interesting end result.
Now, we're taking the next step into the restaurant, bringing those learnings into what we could do to the restaurant business of IKEA.
Yeah.
And that's going to be super fun.
I grew up in a part of London that was filled with derelict houses, which were being smashed down, but had beautiful 19th century tiles. There was no understanding of the beauty of these things. My mother and I used to go out in the middle of the night with a hammer and chisel and rescue them so that they wouldn't be smashed to smithereens by the wrecking ball the next day. I've always, since a child, been fascinated by the atmosphere. And I still am. I think that houses carry the atmosphere of their past. Being a designer in some way gives you X-ray eyes, and you're able to see through the current iteration of a building and how you can build on that. Working on At Hem was a 4.5 year conversation because it had quite a tricky time going through planning and historic permission.
Before collaborating with Ilse, I had Googled her and I understand, you know, wow, she's a rock star. We spent 8 months together. They really took the time to get to know me, showing them, you know, houses and places I liked here in Scandinavia, pointing out, you know, the important things in life. Values, food, the rituals that I care for.
At Hem is in a building built in 1913, which was a really important time in Swedish architectural history because the home became the focus for arts and life. The everyday was something that was celebrated and delightful. So one of the core principles was moving away from opulent luxury to a notion that luxury is attention, it's care. It's actually making the ordinary extraordinary.
Collaborating with Ilse, first of all, it's complete trust. You really feel that. They are very thorough.
Typically, a building process is a sequence of decisions, and what are called the soft decisions are made at the end, if indeed there's any money left at the end, or time. But in this case, we wanted to reverse that process. We wanted to integrate the experience of the place with the design from the very beginning. To make a place where the minute you walked in, you just felt relaxed and as though you belonged. A home, Et Hem, a home.
When we came up with the name Et Hem, it all fell to place. So regarding the design, every decision came back to how does it feel and how is it run in a normal home?
So we got rid of front and back of house, that formality, those boundaries. Not only do they take up space, they also make people behave differently. It's more about the things you do rather than the way things look and how to create a proper focus for those. Those are the moments that make it all worthwhile. In Denmark, they call that hygge, to focus on the moment, on making the ordinary extraordinary, making the normal special. But what happens when you do that is it makes us much more open to each other and much closer. And it's a really interesting way of building community. For example, in the kitchen. So we made it warm and inviting with a great old table, and we chose the things on the table so that they really felt memorable, tactile. Caring about the details, thinking about how people will experience the place. People understand the care that's gone into that. Obviously, Et Hem is a high-end, relatively small hotel. But you can do this on a bigger scale. When you integrate design into a company like Ikea, it can have huge effect. What is so interesting about this project is Ikea is very much a family story. You really see big families here, and it's quite tricky to take a big family out to eat, not to mention quite expensive. So that's a really valuable contribution. The restaurant hasn't kept step with the times. And so they want us to interrogate that.
Well, this is the very area which we're going to take and change it all, hopefully.
Yeah.
We're in one of the oldest stores now of IKEA, and it's the biggest store. Now we're spread to 375 different stores in 48 countries around the world. It was really a new take on how to serve food and, you know, and really good food. But this is the thing, that doesn't matter how good we do our, you know, baked salmon, if you meet it in the wrong way, you get the wrong impression.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like airport security at the moment. It's, you really...
Let's say that it's room for improvement.
Yeah.
We serve 640 million people every year.
And this one alone is something like 3,500, 4,000 a day.
Yes.
It's like big numbers, yeah.
What we want to do with food, just make people live a more healthier and sustainable lifestyle through the food choices.
It makes huge sense, because if you can change the way that children feel about food, that really changes their futures.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think design really needs to address that. If you think about the scale of the project, I mean, 640 million customers a year is beyond comprehension in a way. It's a 10-year plan, and it's only the beginning.
You know, they say that finding a great man deserves a great woman. Here's the opposite. Behind a great woman, maybe there's also a very good man.
I was living in New York. He was living in Milan. He was working for the Design Academy Eindhoven, which I had never heard of.
When we were having a head of department meeting, I was asked if I knew someone that they could recommend for a new design department that was going to be created called Wellbeing. So maybe there's this lady, Ilse Crawford. I only knew about her name and her work from the magazine Elle Decoration. She wrote the book Sensual Home, and for some reason, I never bought it. But actually, I married the one that wrote it, so I didn't have to buy it.
Oscar has been in industrial product design for decades and has joined the business. He's Colombian, so he's brought in this wonderful character and big heart.
This one is the last green touch.
Yeah, that counts as a vegetable for you, doesn't it?
I remember that, wasn't it, in the 14th century in Turkey?
It was grounds for divorce if a woman's husband didn't make her coffee.
Yeah, I usually get up and make you coffee.
Exactly. And I think the small moments are the things you remember in life. I mean, all of us remember those connections.
In the Design Academy, we are both heads of departments. I am the department of mind and activity, which is more about kind of products, services, little experiences. Ilse is the department of well-being, this kind of human engineering of the emotional side, I think.
You know, I really do want well-being in the sense of physical and emotional health to affect as many people as possible, which is why I write the books, why I teach. I hope that it's contagious.
The whole structure of the school is based on using people who are working professionals. So that's allowed me to combine my love of working with the next generation with running my own studio. When you first approached the brushmakers, their immediate answer was no.
Yeah, correct. At the beginning, I think he just thought, okay, he will be gone on this afternoon and then he will not come back. When I came back the second time, he was very surprised. That's when I gained his trust. So the old stick is the one he made 23 years ago, and I put my new broom. And I think that's the conclusion of our relationship, how the new and the old came together in a broom.
Relationships can be a bit messy.
Yeah.
You have to sort of manage through that.
It's really about having these lively dialogues with young individuals and then giving them the toolkits to be able to develop their own voice.
The aim is to enhance the food preparation. It acts like a magnifying lens, so you get a different connection with the food you're preparing.
What I really love about your project is when you look at them, on the one hand, you see kitchen utensils, and on the other hand, you look at this material that you've never really seen used that way.
Exactly.
It's been a really, really great trimester. What I think was probably quite challenging with the project was the collaboration and how that really involves a craft of a relationship. It's actually a really good microcosm of what will happen later on in life, whether you're working on a small scale or a big scale. To be a designer focused on well-being, you have to start with how things are made. You should feel very proud of yourselves for the work you've put in this trimester. So thank you. Being in the school is really being part of that magical process of creation, seeing how things go from nothing to something. And actually now what's happening in Eindhoven, a lot of people are now coming from other cities to go and live there because you've got the opportunity to have workshops, you know, you've got all these different skill sets coming together, a sort of mini Berlin. I think design's got a great future. Well-being is now a philosophy that's permeating a lot of design. My fundamental hope really is that everybody starts to think in terms of putting people first, and that's really something that can be done on an individual basis.
I mean, it's a pretty simple mission. And we do it one space at a time, one piece of design at a time. When you prioritize the human needs within a space, design can have a profound impact. I hope that we can add to the sum of human happiness to leave the world a better place.